it's my pleasure to introduce Caroline Jones, the CEO and founder of Kinda Kids. After receiving her nursing degree from Villanova University, Caroline worked as an ICU nurse at Georgetown University. She then obtained her master's degree from George Washington University and was the director of strategic planning at St. Francis Hospital and the practice administrator for a large medical group. After running a successful strategic planning consulting firm, she began to work as a court-appointed special advocate in 2006. It has been my pleasure to serve as the board chair for the organization and work with Caroline. It is her passion, vision, and commitment that have led to the remarkable growth of this nonprofit. She's an inspiration to me and the board every day as she tips the scales for children in need towards a more hopeful and promising future. Please welcome to the stage our superhero, Caroline Jones.
I appreciate that, and thank you, Scott, for your kind introduction. I'd like to thank my wonderful family, my husband Mark, for his love and support, my son Chris. He flew here from Chicago last night and is flying back later today. My daughter Catherine, who couldn't be here, she's in California right now. But for all of them for working together to make this vision a reality. Let me thank a couple people before I get started, and I'd like to thank our staff, our team. Please stand as I call your name. I know a lot of them are outside or wave. Izuru Osebu Rivers, she's our program director. Colleen Ongs, our outreach and office manager. Patrick Adzadu, our UGrad manager. Tatiana Douglas, our UGrad advocate. And our program manager, Jeanette DeBright. I'd like to thank our educators and part-time staff, Michael Sullivan, Henry Tucker, Wendy Hannon, Audrey Boys, Elaine Jones, Suchat Peterson, and Leland Kent, along with volunteers Rosemary Brooks, Lisa Gerigi, Michael Clemens, and Dawn Manley. Thank you so much. You made this a reality. Thank you to Scott and our board. And our honorees, Dr. Proujansky, representing Nemours, Tracey Carney, our First Lady, wonderful First Lady, Mayda Barrios and Michonne King, our former foster youth, and Amir Phillips. So we all come together, right, we have a common goal, we have a common vision for our children. We all care about our community's children, we're doing what we can to make a difference. At Kind to Kids, we work with children in need. For over 10 years, it's been my privilege to work with children who've been abused, beaten, neglected, and children in poverty. For an abused child, it's so hard to figure everyday life because you've been hurt by the very people who are supposed to protect you and keep you safe. It's hard to trust. They want so much to have a family that they belong to, someone to love and care for them. For many children, their burdens are more than they can bear. Father Greg Boyle says that we should stand in awe of the burdens that people carry, rather than in judgment of the way they carry it. Every other week, we hold life skills classes for children in foster care. And this one particular class for boys 8 to 12 was on thinking about your future and setting future goals. The boys talked about things they'd like to do, and came up with topics like getting their homework done, studying for tests, and practicing basketball. Justin was a quiet and pensive boy, and he didn't want to share his goal out loud. He wrote it down, and he motioned for me to come over, and I could tell it was important because of his urgency. When I saw what he wrote, I understood. It was too raw and too heartfelt to say out loud. My goal is for my mom to get better so I can go home with her. We both looked at each other and I could see the pain and the pleading in his eyes as they filled with water and the tears fell down his face. As I sat down next to him, I shared that his mom needed to work on things and that was for the adults to work out, and that his mom had some things she needed to work on. She had neglected him terribly. She had a severe problem with drug abuse and wasn't capable of caring for him, at least not at that time. We talked about how it was Justin's job to be the best that he could be, to grow strong, to learn, play, and have fun. And that would be the best thing that he could do for both him and his mom. We then went back to class with art therapy and music. And after everyone left the room, Justin came back and gave me a big hug. "Thanks for helping me, Miss Caroline," and ran back out. Now it was my turn to cry, feeling his pain and so very grateful for the opportunity to share and work with him. I watched in awe as he ran outside to catch up with the other boys, his heavy burden just a little lighter. Often a child who's been abused, neglected, and in poverty begin to believe this idea that their lives are worth less than other children who were born into stable families, children who have things due to circumstances outside themselves. Mother Teresa suggests that when a society has problems, it's because we've forgotten that we belong to each other. The great leader Nelson Mandela was often described by a South African word, Ubuntu, the understanding that we're bound together in ways that are invisible to the eye, that there's a oneness to our humanity, and that we achieve ourselves by sharing ourselves with each other and caring for those around us. Brianna was a sweet 8-year-old girl in the midst of a family crisis. Her father had been violent to her and her mom, and they needed to go to the Salvation Army for safety and help. A donor gave us tickets to send kids to a wonderful event at the Grand Opera House, and we were on hand to distribute them to a few children's groups. As everybody settled in, an usher asked Brianna to take her coat off. The puffy coat was making the seats crowded. She pretended she didn't hear the woman and ignored her request. Angry at the girl's defiance, the usher came up to me and was like, "Can you help us? You know, she needs to take her coat off." I went over and asked how I could help. And her mom shared that Brianna thought we found out where they were living, and it was a trick to get them to leave the event. You could tell Brianna's head was bent low and her gaze was fixed on the floor. You could feel the layers of shame upon her, upon this innocent girl, at who and what she was, and that she had this terrible feeling that somehow her life mattered less than other children's. I reassured Brianna that she belonged there and hung up her coat, and she had a wonderful time at the event. So we work to dismantle the barriers that exclude, and we expand horizons. For if we have no peace, we've forgotten that we belong to each other. I'll finish with one last story. We help teens in foster care across the state with classes that teach survival skills to succeed in life and to prepare them after they age out of the foster care system, how to sustain themselves and be successful in life. It's a scary time if a teen has no family to fall back on. The classes are a safe place of strong values of love and kindness. We deliver foundational healing skills to help them deal with their suffering and trauma. In one class on overcoming challenges, the teen got to talk about how they came into care. It was a powerful class. Some of them had experiences as if it was yesterday. Antoine was a big, larger-than-life guy. It looked like he was a lineman for the Eagles. And he hid behind his size with bravado. But he was really a teddy bear inside, a gentle soul. He talked about how he grew up being beaten and emotionally abused by his father, who targeted him as a bad son, who was no good. When he was 16, his father threw him out of the house. He tried to survive on his own on the streets, sleeping behind dumpsters, and relied on food from friends. Eventually, his father notified the state and put him in foster care. As Antoine shared his story, he was in so much pain. He told us how he asked his father, "Why did you put me in care?" And his father said, "Because if I didn't, I was going to put poison in your food." How do you live with that? There was silence as Antoine looked at a piece of his story that only he could see. When he regained his speech, he said, looking broken and despondent, "Why did he hate me?" He was a beautiful child, and he was eventually able to see himself as the beautiful person he was, and that he made the world better because he was in it. But it took strategies, resources, and support to help him get through that dark time. The youth are trying to figure out what happened to them, to make sense of the terrible things they've endured. And they need our help to get through that, because if a child can't figure out what tomorrow looks like, then the present can't hold them, and there's no caring about school or jobs or future or education. So we work with the children in compassion and kindness and find a way toward a future of promise. One teen girl, Kayla, wrote to us after she shared about how her mom had abandoned her and the help that she received. "Thank you for bringing light into my darkness. And I stand in awe of what the children have to carry." So now I'd like to switch gears and introduce my son, Chris. Chris is a co-founder of Kind to Kids, along with my daughter, Catherine. They were the inspiration behind it. As a high school student, he wanted to find a way to give children in foster care and poverty opportunities to attend life events. Over the years, Chris has helped the organization with strategic planning, funding, and board leadership. He continues to help with organizational strategy. After graduating cum laude from Villanova, he worked as a consultant for Deloitte. More recently, he was manager of corporate strategy at Beacon Health Systems in Boston. He's currently an Austin Scholar at Kellogg School of Management at Northwestern University. So I'm proud that he's successful in all these things, but I'm more proud of the young man that he has become. He's thoughtful, he's considerate, he's funny. He's just successful as a human being, which is what I'm most proud of. And then I'd also like to announce that he just got engaged, so we're really excited about that.
Well, thank you very much. I'm thrilled to be here today. And thank you all for coming to the Kind to Kids Spring Celebration. I'd like to continue by thanking our sponsors, the gold sponsors, Beta Beach Builders and Affinity Wealth, silver, Nemours, M&T Bank and Insight, bronze, Bayshore, Capital One, Wisvis Bank, Highmark Delaware, Barnes & Noble, Dover International Speedway, Kenny Family Foundation, Delmarva Power, Delaware Blue Coats, and Platinum Dining Group. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to now introduce my dad, Dr. Mark Jones. After receiving his medical degree from the University of Oklahoma, my dad completed his medical training at Georgetown, where he met my mom, his better half. Together, they moved to Wilmington 30 years ago to raise a family. My mom ran a successful strategic planning business, and my dad practiced pulmonary and critical care medicine. He is a board member of Kind to Kids and is the physician leader of the pulmonary doctors group at ChristianaCare. He has published 10 articles in the medical literature, has been voted Teacher of the Year by the medical house staff, and is consistently voted by his peers to Delaware Today's top doc list. Please welcome my dad, Dr. Mark Jones.
Good morning. Thank you, Chris. The health and well-being of our children are of paramount importance to our families and community. We are fortunate to live in an area served by a superb and nationally recognized children's hospital, Nemours AI DuPont. Nemours founder, Alfred I. DuPont, stated, "It is the duty of everyone to do what is within his power to alleviate human suffering." His legacy of compassion has lived on for more than 70 years through the care and services provided to more than 250,000 children and their families each year through the Nemours Health System. The Nemours mission is to provide leadership, institutions, and services to restore and improve the health of children through care and programs not readily available, with one high standard of quality and distinction, regardless of the recipient's financial status. Throughout the years, Nemours volunteers have supported us by volunteering to make duffels for our My Blue Duffel program and attending the My Blue Duffel Community Service Day in November. We're so grateful for their support. Accepting the award is Dr. Roy Proujansky. Dr. Proujansky received his medical degree from Northwestern University and completed his medical training at the University of Connecticut, Mass General, and Harvard. He is the Executive Vice President and Chief Executive of Nemours Delaware Valley Operations. He is responsible for all clinical operations at the hospital and oversees all patient care and research. This year's Community Service Award winner is Nemours Children's Health System.
I so love posing with tall people. Sorry. Thank you so much, Dr. Jones. It's really a pleasure to be here with all of you, such a committed group of people. And it's great for me to accept this award on behalf of the Nemours Children's Health System. First, I'd also like to recognize our hosts and our honored guests, and I probably don't have everyone on the list, but Governor John Carney and First Lady Tracey Carney, Lieutenant Governor Bethany Hall Long, Representative Lisa Blunt Rochester, Mayor Michael Perzicki, Cabinet Secretary Josette Manning, Kind to Kids founder and president Carolyn Jones, Dr. Mark Jones, co-founders Chris and Catherine Jones, and Board Chair Scott Burris. Thank you so much for this. Thank you all for everything you do each day to help improve the lives of children in Delaware, and more specifically, at-risk children. We know all too well the impact that early childhood trauma and poverty has on the development and the health of children well into their adulthood. I want to take the opportunity to express our gratitude to Carolyn, Mark, Chris and Catherine Jones for creating Kind to Kids in 2011 to help at-risk children. Your life skills, UGrad, and Help a Kid programs truly make a difference here in Delaware. At Nemours, we have a program specifically to provide expert care focused on the exceptional needs of children in foster care. They are, as a group, among the most vulnerable populations of children. Over the past couple of years, Kind to Kids has provided Nemours with several deliveries of My Blue Duffel bags for our foster care children and children placed with alternative caregivers by Child Protective Services. Last year, nearly 50 of our Nemours associates volunteered to help assemble more of those much needed duffel bags. I'm proud of our Nemours associates. They are, by nature, extremely dedicated, compassionate, and empathetic. And every day, they honor the legacy of our founder, Alfred I. DuPont. As you heard, Mr. DuPont believed it is the duty of everyone in the world to do what is within their power to alleviate human suffering. And we talk about that at Nemours. Everything we do at Nemours begins with our mission. We've been promulgating that mission now for close to 80 years. We have been the only pediatric hospital in Delaware offering exceptional services to children who need us. We were originally an orthopedic institute, and we now offer comprehensive care in over 40 specialties. We continue to seek new ways to carry out our mission, to move our mission forward, and to make a difference. And we have purposely worked to bring primary care and specialty care closer to home for children throughout the state of Delaware. Just last week, we had a topping off ceremony with Bay Health, our partners in Milford, Delaware, where we'll be creating a specialty care site, offering primary care, pediatric specialty care, and senior care to people in Sussex County. Over the past several years, we've seen an increase in the demand for behavioral health services, and that's very germane today to today's conversation. Our community needs assessment showed that child mental health services were the number one area of need. We responded by recruiting more providers in psychology, psychiatry, developmental pediatrics, and social work to help provide more care and services for those children, to help with emotional, behavioral, and developmental concerns. And in October, we opened our Behavioral Health, Developmental Medicine, and Swank Autism Center. Recently, as part of a series of activities marking May 2019 as Trauma Awareness Month at Nemours, a group of our leaders met with experts in adverse childhood experiences for a roundtable discussion to explore opportunities for Nemours to become a more trauma-informed institution. We'd like to raise awareness in the larger community and be better equipped to respond to need. At Nemours, we want to see all children grow up healthy and reach their full potential. We understand that the safety, the physical, emotional, and mental health, and the happiness of the child are as important as the science behind the care we deliver. We are proud to carry the legacy of our founder forward with the support of our state, and local leaders. In 1941, part of the dedication of the Alfred I. DuPont Institute went like this. Whenever one of these children shall leap more happily from a bed, whenever the radiant laughter shall supplant the sob of suffering, whenever the radiance comes back to a little face that has been darkened with tragedy, there today and forever will be seen the monument to Alfred I. DuPont. I'm grateful to all of you here today for sharing that responsibility, for being kind to kids, and for helping to provide a better future for every child. Thank you for honoring Nemours with this award.
We're so grateful to have Nemours in our community. What a difference they make for our children. Now I'm going to introduce a short video on our new UGrad program that we've talked about, in which youth in foster care are paired with an advocate to help them through high school, and then 1 year after to get them into college, trade school, or to get jobs. And it's a difficult time with youth. We work with the whole team. We work with leaders like Chief Judge Michael Newell, with social workers like Sophie Sawinski and Jesse Redden, who are here today to help us. We work with schools. We have charter school here today. We have Superintendent Vicki Gert here with us. We have all kinds of community members that we work with, the entire team of the student, to get them together and do the best practices for our children. It's a trauma-informed program. So I'll introduce our video, and which also features our two Rising Star awardees.
Children who are in foster care struggle through no fault of theirs in their education. So this program is actually here to give the youth a voice to be able to initiate how to really focus on their education from 9th grade to 12th grade. The UGrad advocate actually enrolled the youth in the program and also coordinate with teachers, coordinate with DFS workers, the ESPs, and the foster parents. The program is actually youth-centered. The youth is the one who is in charge. The youth is the one who is in the driver's seat, making sure that whatever their needs are, they are able to explain what their needs are, what their challenges are in education.
UGrad program is a program in which foster care kids who are currently in high school gain an advocate for themselves. It helps us with learning new skills, setting new goals, and meeting targets that we set for ourselves as individuals. Kind to Kids has done a tremendous job in giving me a very great support system. Whenever I felt like I didn't have anybody, I could always turn to Caroline or Patrick for any kind of support and help.
Kind to Kids Foundation helps Delaware's most vulnerable children. We help children who are victims of child abuse, neglect, children in foster care, and children in poverty. And we give them a helping hand. The youth identify what their needs are, and we match the youth with the resources that they need to enable them to succeed, to enable them to fulfill their potential, to enable our youth to have bright and promising futures.
Well, I would say for youth in foster care, you know, that are dealing with a dark time, and it can be a really dark time, I believe programs like Kind to Kids can definitely shed some light. It can be almost the greatest source of sunlight because, you know, the name is Kind to Kids, and children need that. You know, it's genuine. It's not just for a statistic, but it's for the well-being of the child, and I really appreciate that.
Introduce Patrick. He's our UGrad manager. Just so you get to meet him and get to know that he's responsible for helping us launch the program. He has extensive experience in doing this. He has graduated from Del State University with a master's in social work. He's obtaining his doctorate in education. He was a behavioral therapist and a supervisor of an independent living program before coming to us, helping youth age out of foster care. So Patrick, can you...
Thank you, everybody, for being here today. As you have all seen, the video speaks for itself. And what we do with the yoga program with Kind to Kid is to make sure that the student, or we say the youth, really understand what it means to have education and what their path is. And we make sure we guide them, make sure we direct them as to what they want to do in future. And we do exactly that. That is what actually makes them successful. Because we've been used to telling everyone what to do and how to do it. And our program is to actually listen to the child and ask them what they want. And that's exactly what UGrad does, and you see what the video just said. And that is why when we have any child in our program, it is very, very, very easy because they are driving the car. We just sitting down and talking to them. So that's how UGrad does. So thank you all for coming, and thank you for everything you do to make this program successful. Thank you.
Can see why the youth love working with Patrick. Now I'd like to introduce our Lieutenant Governor, Bethany Hall Long. Bethany was born and raised in Delaware. She was a nurse after attending Thomas Jefferson University. She obtained her PhD in health policy and nursing administration from George Mason. She's been a member of UD faculty for over 20 years. She's received a university-wide excellence award, and she's currently a professor in nursing and joint faculty in urban affairs. She's known for a community service record for at-risk youth. She was a member of the Delaware legislature, first as a representative and then as a senator. And she is just awesome. We're delighted to work with Lieutenant Governor Bethany Hall Long as she works to improve healthcare, education, and the economy for our families. Please join me in welcoming her.
That was a nurse hug. to all the other nurses in here from Nemours. Wow, what a great day. I have the privilege in a moment of introducing our cabinet secretary who's going to introduce our first award winners. But prior to doing that, I have to say, being here, I know, with our governor, our first lady, and other elected officials, and the room is just full of love. And I know our congresswoman will talk often about love and hope. And I just want to say thank you to the Jones family and Kind to Kids. What you do just warms us and fills our heart with gratitude. And I have to say, I am touched and moved. Mayda will tell you, she has spent time in my office. And I am so proud of you and the work that you do as the Foster Advisory Council Youth. And to each and every one of you who are here today, you are all rock stars to us, and we're so very proud. And I'm proud of Nemours and our First Lady who's being honored, as well as all the other youth in the room. As I know, the judges who are here will tell you that advocacy matters. And when I talk about advocacy, as I do the introduction, cabinet secretaries sometimes are good bosses, right, John? And she said to me, just say my name and my title and get on with it. Well, give me 30 seconds, okay, Secretary Manning? Secretary Josette Manning has the distinguished honor next, I know, of presenting our award winners. But if you've ever met anyone who is a defender, an advocate, and a champion for children, she will be before you in a second. Josette Manning, 16 years in our Department of Justice, amazing trials. Judges understand that, the clinical trials, running from 75 or more, I noticed, misdemeanors to capital murder. But it's about standing up for children. When she ran the special victims unit, her advocacy there, her work with our governor on the Family Services Cabinet Council, addressing trauma and ACEs, making sure in our juvenile justice system that justice is handed for our children, so abuse and neglect are addressed, which is truly the mission of Kind to Kids. And so it is my privilege, and I know our governor's privilege, to have Josette Manning as our cabinet secretary. He will tell you there's no greater defender of children and their advocacy than Josette Manning. Josette.
Can you imagine? Sorry about that. Drop the mic. Can you imagine if I hadn't asked her to just do 30 seconds? Thank you. That was a wonderful introduction. I really do have the best job here today, and I'm going to get to it quickly. I get to introduce two truly extraordinary people. And before I do that, though, I briefly do want to pause to thank our foster parents, our DFS workers who are here with us in the room today, Director Trini Parker, who joined us from DFS. All of our partners and all of our supports, because the reality is, as a state agency, we simply could not do this alone. We need all of the supports that are in this room and beyond in order to have good outcomes for our children and families. I do want to take a moment to especially thank Kind to Kids. They have been a partner for the past 11 years, and they have helped thousands, literally thousands, of foster children, whether it's with their life skills course or those amazing duffel bags, books for children, gifts at holiday time, all those extras that really make a difference between a foster home and a family home that, as a state agency, it's difficult for us to provide. Thank you for your service. There is great work being done in Delaware, and I am very proud and honored to head what is recognized by our national partners as one of the best child welfare agencies in the country. And that's to the credit of those folks sitting over there. But we must recognize that although we are doing great work, as we do that work, we are doing harm. And that is a difficult reality to accept, but we are taking a child from their home. And while that is necessary, it still causes harm. I was reading Foster Care magazine the other day, and it was a magazine, to be honest, that I did not know existed until recently. And there was a section where a former foster youth described foster care, and so there were a few dozen of former foster youth who had written in and described how they viewed foster care. And I wanted to share one with you today. Have you ever had a time in your life when you knew that you had to be strong in order to make it, and that there wasn't anyone that you could depend on but yourself? Now imagine that experience stretched beyond just a moment. Imagine that for years on end, the faces in your life kept changing. This merry-go-round of different faces, some well-meaning but temporary, others harsh and abusive, some caring and honest, others deceptive or even predatory. In the midst of your spinning, swirling life, you found a way to dig down deep and discover fixed points to anchor you. Things like hope, reliability, daring to love, continuing to dream, refusing to give up. And all along the way, you find yourself the unexpected recipient of a fierce and fearless joy. I know I can make it, no matter what. That's foster care. And that was by Lisa Dixon, a foster care advocate. It gives me tremendous pleasure to introduce two young people who I know will make it, no matter what. The Rising Star Award recognizes those youth and young adults who are rising stars in academia and in their communities. Our first honoree is Mayda Barrios. Ms. Barrios is a former youth in Delaware's foster care system. She entered care while in high school and went on to graduate from St. George's Technical School. Last year, Mayda was awarded the Destined for Greatness Award and helped Lieutenant Governor Bethany Hall Long preside over the state Senate as her job shadow for a day. Mayda is currently a student at Delaware State University, and she is majoring in education. She is on the dean's list, and she plans to become a teacher. Mayda is active with campus life and is part of the Enliven group that supports nursing home residents, homelessness, and youth in foster care by providing food and mentoring services. She serves as the president of the Youth Advisory Council, which meets monthly to discuss ways to improve the foster care system in Delaware. She currently works part-time in a preschool. I can't imagine how she could fit any much more into her life. It is my true honor to introduce to you our rising star, Mayda Barrios.
This morning. Second, I would like to thank Patrick and Caroline for always being so kind to me. From the moment I met them several months ago, they wanted nothing but the best for me. They give me continuous support in my educational goals, my career goals, and my personal goals. Next, I would also like to thank my support system, my workers, my judges, well, my judge, my only judge, my previous foster parents, my teachers in high school, my mentors, and most importantly, my high school guidance counselor, who unfortunately could not be here this morning, but took me in as one of her own after graduating high school. Words can't express how blessed I am to be standing here today receiving this award. This award means the absolute world to me. It reminds me every day how far I've come in my life. Coming into foster care at the age of 15, after intentionally running away, I did not see myself where I am today. I'm a high school graduate, a full-time worker, and currently working on my bachelor's in early education. In my short 3 years in foster care, I was faced with many challenges. My father passed away when I was 13, leaving me with no choice but to go to foster care when I ran away. I wanted nothing to do with my mother. She showed me no interest and even wanted me to come back home. I came to the conclusion that if I wanted a better future for myself, I had to work for it. My future has no limits. I haven't given up yet, and after making it this far, there is no giving up. I live by the quote, never let your past define your future. Thank you.
Our second honoree for the Rising Star Award is Rashawn King. Mr. King is also a former foster youth, Delaware, and like Mayda, also entered care while he was in high school. Rashawn is a graduate of Smyrna High School and is now attending Delaware State University as well. Rashawn serves as the Vice President of the Youth Advisory Council under President Barrios. Rashawn is an accomplished musician. He is majoring in music education, and he plans on becoming a music instructor at the collegiate level. Rashawn serves as a piano accompanist for many community events, and he is involved in the Methodist Student Association at DSU, so much so that they refer to him as Mr. Methodist. It is my honor to present the Rising Star Award to Mr. Rashawn King.
Soak this in. Wow. First of all, good morning to everyone. Wow. I have so many people to thank. I'm not even going to try to start with names because I'll forget someone. But to anyone who has invested in me, just thank you. It's greatly appreciated. Now, Mayda and I, we were asked just to share a bit of our story. And I'm so honored that we've been given the opportunity to do so. So, of course, I would first like to thank God for this great opportunity. And I would also like to thank Kinda Kids, Mr. Patrick, Miss Caroline. They have shown tremendous support and just relentless love and kindness to me. So thank you. Thank you for that. I would just like to just very briefly share a passage from a psalm written by King David. And it reads, "The Lord is my shepherd." Although I've experienced many challenges as a child and as a foster youth, I've always found comfort in knowing that the Lord is my shepherd. King David of the Bible is very special to me for many reasons, but the most important reason amongst these is that David was a musician and he worshiped the Lord, and he also was an abandoned child. In times of trouble, he hid behind his songs from his heart and hymns to God. And he did this so often that there's a 150 chapter book that includes these love songs alone to God. And like David, I found solace in a hymn. This hymn reads, "In seasons of distress and grief, my soul has often found relief and has often escaped the tempter's snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer." That is my foster care experience. And I would just like to say one last thing. Being a foster youth was very interesting. It's a very interesting chapter in life. It was bittersweet, it was beautiful, but it also was unfortunate. But I will say that I'm not just a foster youth because I was placed in a foster home. I'm a foster youth because when my mother and father forsook me, it was the Lord and only the Lord who was willing to take me in. Thank you.
Today with Mayda and Rashawn has been the highlight of my week, if not my year, if not my career. So with that, I will turn the program back over to Caroline. Thank you, and congratulations to you both.
Thank you, Secretary Manning. Congratulations again to Mayda and Rashawn. We're so proud of you and all you've accomplished. You're amazing. Now I'd like to introduce Congresswoman Lisa Blunt Rochester. She's such a strong advocate and support for our children. We're grateful for all that she does. She sits on the House Committee of Energy and Commerce, and she's the Assistant Whip for House Leadership. She focuses on reducing the health cost of health care and prescription drugs for our families, and addressing disparities in outcomes of community of color, and tackling our nation's opioid epidemic. She grew up in Wilmington, she graduated from Fairleigh Dickinson, and she put herself through graduate school as a working mom. She earned a master's degree in urban affairs and public policy from UD. She made history in 2016 when she was elected to Congress as the first woman and first African American to represent the state in such a role. She's been reelected to serve a second term, and her plans to continue to fight for the Affordable Care Act, for civil rights, and rights of women for all of us. Please welcome me, and please join me in welcoming Congresswoman Lisa Blunt Rochester.
Good morning. Good morning. That's what I'm talking about. First of all, I would love to acknowledge Caroline and the Jones family for your leadership in even creating Kind to Kids. To the staff, I don't know if we've given you a round of applause yet, but to the staff of Kind to Kids, show them some love. To Scott and the board of directors, to the sponsors, to the volunteers, to all of the family, I'll just call it the Kind to Kids family, I want to just say thank you. Thank you so much for being on the battlefield. Our governor is here, our mayor, our city council president, Hanifa Shabazz, was here. There are a lot of folks to recognize, but I do want to take a moment to highlight the honorees. Nemours, for your tireless work on behalf of children in our state and in our country. We really thank you and appreciate you. To Mayda and Rashawn, okay, first of all, I'm like pumped up. So the people next to me were like, good luck, you gotta follow them. It's like, wow, thanks for the support. But for me, it wasn't about good luck. It was about praise the Lord. Like, this is like beautiful to see. You are a living testament to what this is all about, right? This is why we are here. And you are a beautiful representation. You know, the theme is a future for every child. You're the future. And you make us so proud. So I just want to one more time give you a round of applause. Rising superstars in the room, in the house, get their autographs today. You can say you knew them when. And one of the things that I love is that they're focused on education. They want to be teachers, instructors, and carry on the legacy. So thank you for that. But this morning, I get the incredible honor to present an award to a friend. Now, last year, Tracey, I don't know her as Tracey Carney, I know her as Tracey Quillen, but Tracey Quillen Carney got the opportunity to introduce me. And she was really, I was really pleased. She said, you know what, I'm not even gonna go off of the bio that's in your program. She did a little stealth move and called my sister to get some sneaky background information on me. So this year, it's payback time. And I'm so excited to really just salute an incredible woman, a woman that is a friend, but also an advocate. We know her by different ways. I thought of the song, I'm Every Woman, because she's a sister, she's a mother, she's a daughter, she's a friend, she's an advocate. But when I gave a little call to her husband, John Carney, our governor last night, I said, tell me some inside scoop, something that's not in the bio. I see everybody leaning in. They're all leaning in right now. And so John and I were talking, and he mentioned the fact to me that just how strong of a woman she is, and the fact that in all of his jobs, even when he became governor, she said, okay, don't get it twisted, I am not a tag-along. She is not a tag-along. She comes as the full wholeness of Tracey Quillen. And he talked to me about just the protective spirit that she has, even as a mother, to the point that when the family were, when he was involved in different things, whether it was political or public service, she made sure that her children still had a safe environment that did not have the demands that we as parents might put on them. She made sure that her sons, Sam and Jimmy, were taken care of. At one point in her career, she even gave up a job working for then Senator Biden. Now, mind you, for 15 years, she's a consummate writer. She's a consummate professional. But she wanted her children to have the kind of experience she had at Friends, a Quaker education. And so she went to work for that organization just to get a discount so that her kids could go there, because that was important to her. She is a mother, an advocate. And many of us know that that protective spirit actually translated into her current role. Some would call it First Lady, but First Lady, that's, Tracy's like, she doesn't really, she's not that First Lady type. So I decided instead to call her Number One Woman. Instead of Delaware's First Lady, she's Delaware's Number One Woman. And in that role, we have seen her take on the role of champion with her First Chance Delaware initiative, which has three pillars. One, to end childhood hunger here in Delaware. Two, to advance childhood literacy, early childhood literacy. And lastly, to focus on childhood trauma, which she has created with the governor's leadership and the secretary's leadership and many of you in this room, a national model. She believes in breaking down barriers and silos. And ultimately, her Quaker infusion has actually made her believe and see the divine in all of us. I want to share a few words that I think Tracey is, and then we will bring her up. When I think of Tracey, I think of a woman who has eyes that are mischievously shimmery. When you see her and she gets an idea, there's a spark that comes in her eyes. She is a woman who actually wears glasses as headbands. Anybody who sees her, like right now, her glasses are always pushed back on her head as if to be a headband. She is a thinker, a problem solver, a collaborator, and a tearer down of barriers. To her core, to her marrow, not just her bones, but to her marrow, she believes that no child should be cast away, and that all children deserve a first chance so that they don't need a second chance. Ladies and gentlemen, she is our Eleanor Roosevelt because she believes deeply in public service. She is our Jackie Kennedy because she is a writer above writers and has class. She is our Barbara Bush because she's a mama bear. And I have to tell you, we actually modeled together in the Fun for Women fashion show, so she's got a little Melania Trump in her, too. Just say it. But ultimately, just a little. But ultimately, I love her because she is like Michelle Obama to me. A heart, right? Michelle Obama. She's got the heart, she's got the head, and she's got the hands to do the strong work. Ladies and gentlemen, our Wonder Woman, Delaware's first woman, please welcome to the stage to receive the Community Leader Award, Tracey Quillen Carney.
If I were smart, I would sit down. But I'm nowhere near as smart as Lisa made me out to be. So here we go. Thank you so much, friend. What a lovely, I don't know how to describe that, but thank you very much. Thank you to Scott and your board, including my friend Dawn Manley, who first introduced me to Kinda Kids. Thanks to Chris and Catherine, and Dr. Mark and our pediatric partners at Christiana Care. I didn't know you were in the pulmonary group. Now I know who to blame for my CPAP machine. Thank you to the Kinda Kids staff, and to Caroline, my friend and our president. Thanks for giving me a chance to have breakfast with my husband. In order to be here at 7:30, I got up early and he slept in. Thanks to everyone who has taken and will take the podium this morning. What a privilege to be in your company. Our partners at Nemours, every day, one child, one family at a time, in community engagement and advocacy for children, you more than live up to your founder's legacy of equity in healthcare and compassion in all things. As for my friends, Mayda and Sean, I said, you'll see in your program, there's a picture of the three of us together. After I saw it, I said, I'm never taking a picture with them again. Mayda looks like a model, and Rashawn has this smile that I cannot compete with, but Lisa Morris told me to take a picture with them this morning, so I do what Lisa tells me, and we did it again, so we'll have another picture. All I can say about these two young people is wow. Dr. Proujansky mentioned the word radiance, and talk about radiance, there it is. I've seen you in action at the YAC, I've read about you, and I'm proud to be your junior partner in the work to extend the pilot program at DSU to all of the colleges and universities in Delaware. I cannot imagine a greater privilege than to try to be a partner, an advocate, a convener on behalf of Delaware's children and youth. We are a perfect match. They can't vote, and I'm not elected. At our symposium kicking off Delaware's first Trauma Awareness Month, for which we thank our governor, one of our keynote speakers shared a tradition from the Maasai tribe in Africa. The Maasai, who are known to be warriors mostly, but they have a traditional greeting, which translates as, "And how are the children?" It's how they say hello, how are you doing? They ask, how are the children? And even Maasai who have no children of their own answer in times of peace, all the children are well. All the children are well means that life is good. That's the yardstick, friends, a measure that Kinda Kids reminds us to strive for always. By being here this morning, you recognize the consequence of that call to action. And again, all I can really say is thank you.
To our First Lady and First Power Woman, Tracy Carney, for being such a strong advocate for our children. I'm gonna introduce a video. It's a short video in our Life Skills program. It's called our After School or Kinda Kids Club for kids. We work for kids in priority one schools and community centers, high need areas, and we help children with socio-emotional skills. It's trauma-informed, and it helps the kids feel understand themselves and make good decisions for a better future. So with that, I'd like to introduce the video, which also features one of our stars today.
The students that have been in the Kinda Kids program, their attendance has excelled since being a part of the program. They're coming to school on time. They're coming to school prepared and ready to learn. And once again, like I said, they're overall excited about Tuesday because they know they're going to be in the Kind of Kids program, participate in all the fun activities, receive some treats, and they learn a lot as well. So they learn how to problem solve, coping mechanisms, how to be partners, how to be peer mentors to one another. And starting today, they were actually learning coding on iPad. So that's a new program that we're going to be bringing to our students. And I know once they're able to be a part of that, they're going to be really excited and hope to continue the program here at Stubbs Elementary School.
It's a fun game. You have to follow directions and make sure you can make mistakes. All people make mistakes, but you have to figure out how to use your mind to make moves with the arrows. Good decisions help because if you have like all good report cards when you get older and you want to go to college, you can get accepted into a Royal College like Howard. When we do our projects and we create them and we put our own design to it, like it makes me feel good because if I had like a down day, it would make me smile. What I like about Carney Kids classes is that when I read in this class, I learn important words and I feel good about myself because first I didn't know how to pronounce the words and now I do. And I like that when the whole class is reading, we all listen and we don't interrupt and like we all get along with each other and not mean to each other. I wanted to be a basketball player and a lawyer when I get older and maybe be a big person in life.
Tracey Carney to present an award for our special guest today, Amir Phillips. Amir, could you come up?
When I spoke earlier, I had to resist the temptation of mentioning this year's Student Leader Award winner. I am so pleased now to be able to introduce Amir Phillips to you and present his recognition. If you like Amir or Amir?
It don't matter.
If you read about Amir in your program, you'll see that he is at age 11 an established leader in the Kind of Kids After School program, the Kind of Kids Club, which includes both academics. He mentioned to me his favorite is math and life skills, real life skills, like stress management, decision making, and acting upon the importance of kindness and compassion. You also heard that Amir hopes to be an important person someday, maybe a lawyer, maybe a basketball player, maybe both. Len Elmore and Jay Billis, both of whom we see on ESPN and CBS during basketball games, they did both. They played basketball and went to law school. That's pretty impressive. But the thing is, Amir is an important person already. Impressive in his own right. Not just because of what he can do in the future, but because of who he is right now. Amir, we honor you as a representative of Kind of Kids Club and of your generation, as a leader among the students who are the highest of our hopes, the best of our ideals, and the deepest of our obligations. Please join me in congratulating the Kind of Kids Student Leader Award winner, Amir Phillips.
Thank you for being here today.
He has a bright future in front of him. I look forward to hiring Amir someday as a lawyer. So next I'd like to introduce someone who's very special to our community, Mayor Michael Przycki. He's doing an amazing job of reinvigorating the city of Wilmington. He's reducing crime, he's expanding businesses, our economy, quality education for our children. He's been such an advocate for Wilmington's children in need. He collaborates and he works with city officials, with the government, with activists and nonprofit organizations like Kind to Kids to improve neighborhoods and education. He's making Wilmington a thriving regional destination. You can see it when you walk through, it's amazing. The riverfront culture, it's really exciting. Business housing, so we're appreciative of his efforts and we welcome Mayor Mike Przycki. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Caroline. John, what are you going to say to top of this? I mean, I can't wait to see what you've got up your sleeve, because I'm like, what am I doing here after I'm here? I'd like to thank, join the chorus of those who thank the Jones family for everything you do. I want to spend just a special nod to our family court judges. Don't know how you do it every day, and we're grateful. I'd like to thank Mayda, Rashawn, and Amir for lifting our hearts today. Rashawn, I've got an opening for a speechwriter. I know it's a little early in your career, but if I give that speech, I'm getting elected everything. I mean, that's just beautiful. People are always talking to me about what, you know, about the city and how we solve the problems and on. And it's a terribly complex issue, but it's got to start with building our neighborhoods, strengthening our neighbors, and helping our kids. We've got kids in the system today who, if 15 years ago, had the attention that Kind of Kids pays to other kids, might not be there today. And it's an enormous job. You know, social behaviors, human behavior is just so complex. But nonetheless, one thing I'm certain I know, and that is that a kid with arms wrapped around them is a whole lot better than a kid who feels abused in any number of ways. A week or two ago, Principal Brown, I visited Stubbs. Stubbs is a wonderful school. Stubbs is a great kid, a great school. And there are kids all over that just look like Amir. They're bright, they've got optimism in their face, they've got imagination that shows. I mean, these kids deserve every resource in the world we can give them. And I congratulate you, frankly, for the work you do over there. I felt just so good visiting. John, best thing I can say about you is you married Melania. everybody knows John's, I'm going to sit down shortly. Everybody knows John's bio. He's been a long-serving public servant, 30 years in public life, served as our not only our governor, but our lieutenant governor. Sit down, relax, will you please? And he's served us so well. He's a wonderful friend. So in these introductions, you'd like to just say a few things nobody knows. John was there at the job interview when I interviewed for the Riverfront Development Corporation in 1996. I think he had something to do with my hiring. So if you're happy with what I've been doing at Mayor, it wouldn't have happened without John Carney. So that's one big thing. The other thing is, you know, as we get older, everybody forgets about what we did when we were young. And John was a great football player at Dartmouth. And one day I met one of his teammates who went off to be an NFL coach. It was either David or Mike Shula, I forget which one. And we talked about, he said, "Do you know John Carney?" I said, "Of course I know John Carney." He said, "You know, he was the toughest football player I ever had play with me." Now, this guy coaching the NFL, and who does he remember but this guy with all his headshots he took over the years? That's how he can do what he's doing. But what people also don't know is that, you know, one day, look, John brought back the Family Cabinet Council because he cares for kids. He's gotten tens of million dollars for our elementary school because he knows that our under-resourced kids need additional support. A couple of years ago, we sat in my office, he was talking, he said, "I have to go. Where do you have to go?" "I have to go to Ferris. I go to Ferris every week to meet with the kids over there. And I said, well, why don't you just have them call back to our office and maybe we can take one of those kids for an intern. And he did, instantly. And we did, by the way, and it was one of the great experiences of our life. John cares a lot about our kids. He cares a lot about the city of Wilmington. I'm proud to call him our friend and our governor, John Carney.
Thank you, Mike, and thank you for our partnership, the things that we're doing here in the city of Wilmington, the important work that you mentioned. I don't know about you, but my heart is really full. I mean, it's been expanding as the morning has gone on. I have a confession to make, though, and that is this. I was talking to Carol Ammon as we were getting ready to sit down, and we're trying to schedule a meeting, and it's been pushed off, and she said something about what the date was. I said, I don't really know the date. I can only look at the one day at a time. And then if I do that, I can get through my schedule and it's not a problem. But if I look at the whole week or 2 weeks or a month, it just feels so overwhelming. Well, the fact of the matter is I didn't really look at the schedule for today very carefully. I knew Tracey was going to get an award, and I expected I'd come here and have a nice breakfast, kick back my legs, have a cup of coffee, and then enjoy her moment in the spotlight. As we're driving over, she said, boy, you got a busy day today. You got to speak several times. I said, no, I'm only speaking once later today at the University of Delaware. Got news for you, Buster. You're the featured speaker at the breakfast this morning. Buster. I don't know who this Tracey Carney person is. She's always been Tracey Quillen to me, and still Tracey Quillen. She adopted the Carney point part when the boys went to school. But as I'm sitting here, I'm just thinking about how lucky I am to be your governor, with all the people in this room, with Carolyn and kind of kids, and the tremendous work that you do, the whole family. It's a whole family commitment. You've sucked us all in. I was talking to Dr. Jones. I said, this woman is a force of nature. Everybody in the room is shaking their head. And really, that's what it takes. It really takes all of us. Excuse me. And that's what makes me, as your governor, so incredibly optimistic, notwithstanding the difficulty. And we know how hard it is. We've got the family court judges here that see this every day. And God bless you, as the mayor said, for the tremendous work that you do. Very incredibly difficult work that you do, and everybody in this room does incredible work. I want to congratulate the honorees. I don't know what we'd do in Delaware without Nemours. They're just an incredible institution that provides unbelievable medical services for our children. All of us, we had a young son who decided he was going to ride his bicycle with training wheels down Monkey Hill. One of his cousins convinced him that was a good idea. Well, if you know Monkey Hill, there's a big tree right at the bottom. And he and his bike found that tree. And I got a call from my brother-in-law. He said, John, you better come over here. Something's happened. It's not very good. I get there, and my son is shaking. He's having a concussion. We took him to Nemours, just up the street from where we live, and he was given such incredible care. And we just appreciate everything that you do in our state. And what do you say about these students? Are they just unbelievable? Just unbelievable. Rashawn, I'm taking you with me today. You're gonna give that next speech. And I want all of it. I want the Bible verses. I want you to sing a song. I want the whole thing, the whole nine. University of Delaware, this afternoon, you and me, we're going there. And you look in a mirror and you say, this is why we're all doing this, right? This is why we do this. Let me tell you a quick story. I love visiting schools. You know, my job can get stressful and you can get kind of depressed by things, that some of the challenges that you face. But guess what? If you go in to visit an elementary school, man, it'll lift you right up. I don't care where it is. And so I love going there. Sometimes when my staff can't find me, they say, well, check the elementary schools across the state. It's probably in one. And one particular morning, about a year or so ago, I started off my day at the Head Start facility out on Northeast Boulevard. And by definition, these are preschool children, right? And there were like probably 3, 4, maybe some 5-year-olds. And I went in there to talk to them. And it was amazing the difference among them. There was one little girl. She knew the answers to every question. And she was jumping off the floor to answer. And she had just all kinds of thoughts. And then others kind of cowered away a little bit. And you just wondered, was there something wrong with them? And I had a wonderful time, a wonderful visit, great work that they do there. Then we left there and we went out to North Star Elementary School. North Star is out in Hokesson, if you're not familiar with it. And there were a group of third graders, I guess, another group of all little girls, and they were bringing me out there to show what they were doing to save the planet. Planting trees, because trees give off oxygen and take in carbon dioxide. And I was just blown away, and their parents were there, and there were engineers for DuPont and for this and that, and I thought of the tremendous resources that these little girls got, and they were just bright and shiny, just like the kids over in Northeast Boulevard. And I thought to myself as I left that day that our job is to make sure that both sets of those children have the opportunity to be successful in life, right? A future for every child. Not just one group or the other, not just the group that lives out in Hokesson, another group, but the little children that grow up on the east side. And we have poured in a ton of effort. There's nothing more important that I do in my job than what we're doing to improve schools in the city of Wilmington, invest in our children. Nothing more important than what we're doing. And so the work that all of you do is so incredibly important for this work. My job's kind of the easy part. Another visit I had, second graders at North Star Elementary, there was a little girl, they had put this little, usually little children are sitting in front of me, and I get to, like the talk show host, hey, what's your question, or what do you have to say, you know. This little girl said, I'm in charge, I'm gonna ask you the questions. And she said, well, the questions are written on the board next to you. And I was going down, I was picking the easy questions, right? And she said, Governor, could you take the questions one at a time? Second, third grader. The next question was, what's your most important job as governor? I was avoiding that question because I really hadn't thought about it in that way. I had run for governor once unsuccessfully, you might remember that. I was lieutenant governor for 8 years. I worked for a governor, I know what governors do. But I hadn't thought so much about that specific question because I don't go out there and teach schools. I don't work with families in crisis and children that are being abused. I don't go out there and patrol the streets like our troopers. I don't do any of that. But I thought at that moment that my job is to help all of you do your jobs and to do it better. That's my job. And when I look out and I see all of you, and I see our congresswoman who's fighting every day for us in Washington, and bringing that inspiration back and working with our delegation, when I see our cabinet secretaries and the tremendous work that they do, when I know we've got the best judiciary in the country, and I know how difficult the work is, when I know that I've got an organization like this that we do in our state, we've got a hospital like Nemours. If there's any place in the country who can do this work and do it successfully, we can do it here in Delaware. We should do it here in Delaware. So I forgot something. This is what happens when you're not prepared to speak. My wife, she got an award 10 minutes ago, and I haven't said anything about her. Congresswoman Blunt Rochester and I talked last night. I like to refer to her as my sister, because her father and my father worked together years ago in the old Wilmington Public Schools. And so I know them from way back. In fact, this is off script, so I better be careful. When I was playing basketball in high school, Ted, her father Ted, and a guy by the name of Major Hairston, they organized the summer travel team. This was before travel teams were anything. And my dad and Ted worked together, so Ted said, well, hey, would your son like to play on this team? I was a suburban white kid, right? He said, I got all these kids playing with this team. Are you kidding me? I'm gonna play. And we toured all around, we had great fun. And it was a tremendously opening, widening experience for me as a high school student. And so I've always felt a particular affinity with the Blunt family, and now Lisa's doing a great job as our congresswoman. One of the expressions that we have in Congress, when somebody says something meaningful, there's not a lot of time on the House side, because there are 435 members, is I'd like to associate myself with the remarks of the gentlewoman from Delaware and all that she said about my beautiful wife, incredibly talented wife. She mentioned the Quaker thing. My wife's not a Quaker, but she is bought in 100% to that Quaker ethic about the light in everyone and seeing the divine in everyone. This award, I'm sure, is means something to her, but she got the biggest award that a mother could want, a parent could want, 2 weeks ago. When our youngest son graduated from college with women, like we're two English majors. This young man walked across the stage at Tufts University with an engineering and computer science degree. I mean, and he had all these awards, you know. He got his college cumulative average was higher than any one term average that I had when I was in college. Computer science. And my wife deserves so much of that credit for that. And I know she is so proud of our son's success. And our other son is incredibly successful as well. So Tracey, congratulations, and thank you for the tremendous work that you know, you could maybe tell by her remarks that you can't get over full of yourself if you're governor or anything in my household. I got news for you. When I start complaining, Carol, about my schedule, she says, no victims, only volunteers here, pal. I don't want to hear it. But to Tracey Quillen and to Time for Kids and everybody in this room who are engaged in this really tremendously important work, there's nothing that we're doing right now in state government and there are some state elected officials here. Thanks for coming, Mike, and others were here earlier, and the mayor, the work that we're doing together in the city of Wilmington. And he's exactly right. It's hard work. It's about building strong communities, strong families, and making sure that every child, like Amir, has a chance to be successful in life. And we can't do it without all of you. Thank you very much, and God bless you.
Amazing. Thank you so much. That was exciting and inspiring and warm. And I hope you all are as inspired as I am and all of us are here today to hear these stories, to meet these amazing youth who are succeeding despite so many obstacles and Amir. And I hope you're also inspired by coming together, by our programs, by the way we help children and meet the needs to give them the resources they need to succeed in life. You go back to basics, right? It's people together, helping each other. It's how we get things done. We bring hope and the needed skills and resources to our children. And you see their eyes get bright with hope. And they're dreaming. And we're taking their hand and walking together toward a bright future. So please, as you leave today, take your pledge cards with you. You could drop them in the baskets on the way out. I thank you for your support. It helps us to change lives. I'm grateful that you are all here today to make our vision a reality. Thank you for reminding me, like Mother Teresa said, that we belong to each other. Have a great day.